Usually steps were done with this. Now next, our discussion will be on the capacitive type accelerometer. Fine. So capacitive type accelerometer is also the similar to our capacitive pressure sensors. Here what will happen? Because of the applied accelerations or the applied force, the capacitance will change, right? And if you here also the main accelerometers will be put inside the frame. And here again the basic principle remains same. When that whole things will be put or installed on the platform which is subjected to the vibration or the acceleration, and when the accelerations will be applied, the frame will be moving, and the inside mass spring damper systems will be also moving, and there will be some relative displacement. Fine. Now in the previous case, that relative displacement or the stress, so that was converted in resistance, and resistance was converted into voltage, and that was the basic principle of the piezoresistive. Whereas in case of capacitive, that displacement change will be converted into that capacitance change, which will be further converted to voltage with the help of the circuits, and that will give you the measurement of the unknown acceleration quantity. Fine. So here, if you look at the design of the capacitive accelerometer, so what you can see that here these are the substrate, fine, and here this one is my seismic mass or the proof mass, and this is the spring, this is the spring, this is the substrate again. So this internal is my actual mass spring damper system accelerometer device, fine. And since we have to deal with that capacitive configuration, so that's why here we have put or deposited one electrode, here we have put another electrode, so that we can call as the top electrode, this one we can call as the bottom electrode, fine. Now when this particular mass spring system or the accelerometer device will be subjected to some acceleration, so then what will happen? This is the mass and these are the springs, so these are the fixed region, this is the fixed region, this is the fixed region, and this middle portions and is the moving region with the help of these connecting springs or flexors. Now when it will be moving in either sides, so basically due to the applied accelerations, this will be moving in upwards or downwards, fine, and that means it will be having some sort of displacement. Now in order to change the displacement into change in capacitance, what we need? We need some extra frame or what we call as the casing, and that casing, so these are the casings that can be typically some sort of glass or pyrex, right? So that type of material casing, and both in the downward side as well as top side as well as the bottom sides, we will be putting the casing, and that will be connected to this substrate region, and in that means aligning with respect to this electrode on this casing also, we will put one electrode at the bottom side, another electrode at the top side, fine. Now this casing means that is similar to the frame, fine, and so that means this whole things, when it will be placed on the platform which is vibrating, then this particular, there will be relative motion between this casing and this mass spring damper system, and so if it goes upward side, so what typically you can think of, suppose this one is the this upper side, that casing side, the electrodes top and bottom what we have, they can be considered as the reference electrode, and these will be considered as the sensing actual sensing electrode. So suppose if it move upwards, so then what will happen? The gap between in the upper side, the gap will decrease, whereas the lower side gap will increase. Now if this particular mass spring system move downwards, so then here the gap will decrease, whereas in this side the gap will increase, fine, and accordingly we can have some sort of differential capacitance, right? Because we know that parallel plate capacitance means C equals to epsilon A by D, and in this case the D is changing, fine. So if it goes in either side, so one side the gap is increasing, another side gap is decreasing, accordingly one side capacitance, if we calculate the capacitance, one side capacitance will increase, another side capacitance will decrease, fine, and that again we can connect it to some circuits which can convert this delta C into the corresponding voltage output, okay. So that is the basic principle of the capacitive type accelerometers, right? Now we will discuss the further details on this capacitive accelerometer as well, Now, before that, let us summarize, let us look at the advantages and disadvantages of this device. So what are the advantages? Since it deals with the capacitance thing, so it will not be affected by the temperature, right? Then its response is good, DC response and the noise performance as well. Drift is less, drift we have defined, right? So drift means with age or with time, how much shifting is there? That means at zero value, what is the shifting, or what is the shifting in its sensitivity? So those things, so those shiftings are less, and its sensitivity is quite high, and the power dissipation is also quite less, because in case of piezoresistive, the power dissipation is more, right? Because that is the resistive element, and in that piezoresistive we have that I square R loss, so that's why there the power dissipation is more, whereas in case of capacitive type, the power dissipation is less, right? So those are the advantages. Now if we look at the disadvantage, so then disadvantage is the main thing is the parasitic capacitance or the stray capacitance effect, right? So very difficult to eliminate these type of effects completely. So that's why this will come under the major disadvantage, right? So obviously there are relative advantage and disadvantage, and based on our requirement, we have to choose what type of configurations we want to use, right? Is it okay? Yeah. So here again, just the some theoretical aspects we have shown. So suppose this capacitive accelerometer means that because of the applied accelerations or the force, the displacement will change, and that displacement will be converted into the change in capacitance, right? So here you can have different configurations. Like if you look at the first one, so here just only two plates are there, and as we know that parallel plate capacitance total we have three parameter. One is the overlap area, another is the gap between the electrodes, and another is the dielectric medium. So here can you tell that what is the dielectric medium? Yeah, so dielectric medium should be air. Why? Because the plate has to move in between, and typically if this dielectric medium is air, right? So here this we call as the single capacitor, where capacitance is a function of gap or area. So if it moves in gap changing time, or it can move in overlap area changing time as well, right? But it can be nonlinear. Then again, another capacitance we can have, that is called as the differential capacitance. So differential capacitance means in that case essentially we need three plates. So the middle one will be moving plate, and the top and bottom will be the fixed plate. So if it move upwards, so then this in the upper sides the gap will decrease, so that means capacitance will increase, whereas in the lower side the capacitance will decrease. And if it move the middle portion, if the middle electrode or plate move downwards, so then in the lower side the capacitance will increase, and in the upper side it will decrease, or vice versa. Fine. So this is the called as the differential electrodes. Now apart from that, we have some other type of electrode configuration, like this is called as a floating electrode. So this is differential overlap type. So that means it can go either this side or this side. Accordingly, some overlap area is changing, and we can measure the capacitance between these two and these two, or vice versa. Fine. We can have some interdigitated configuration as well, where suppose this left side there connected in these configurations, and in the right side they are connected in this configuration, and one side will be, suppose if this left side, if this moves in this horizontal way, so then what will happen, the overlap area with respect to this right side will change, right? So obviously that here we have two sets of beams, right? One is the left side, another is the right side, and only one side will be moving, another side will be the reference or fixed, right? Similarly, here also we have the interdigitated configurations, and this is one typical symbol, circuit symbol, where differential capacitance we have. Like for this particular examples, or this differential capacitance, if we want to model it in this fashion, so then these three plates can be modeled in this C1 and C2, right? Because this upper plate and the middle plate, they will form one capacitance C1, and the middle plate and the lower plate, they will form another capacitance C2. And in this configuration, suppose if C1 increase, then C2 decrease, or the vice versa, right? So this is the circuit model. So this is just to have the idea that what is the that basic theoretical mechanisms behind this capacitive type accelerometer, right? Now we will further illustrate the capacitive type accelerometer. So here we have shown that what are the technologies used for this capacitive accelerometer. So you must remember that during the fabrication technology discussions, what we told that we have mainly two type of micromachining technology. One is called as the bulk micromachining, another is called as the surface micromachining, fine, and another can be the combination of both bulk and surface. So basically that we have seen this particular capacitive accelerometer diagram previously, and what we told that this one is the middle portion is the proof mass, and these are the two springs, and these are the anchored or fixed region, fine. Now in order to make it the capacitive sensing point of view, in the upper side and the lower side we need some sort of casing that can be of glass or pyrex like this, and there the objective is here we will put one electrode, here another electrode. So for that purpose we have to have this type of arrangement, right? So essentially what we can understand that this one is typically the silicon, which is the main accelerometer device, and the upper side and lower sides, they may not be the silicon, they can be pyrex or glass like this. So they are completely two different materials, fine. So what type of technology we can use for fabricating this type of capacitive accelerometer? So this is the first one, that is the bulk silicon micromachining and wafer bonding, right? So what do we mean? A silicon middle wafer, this is the silicon middle wafer that is anodically bonded to two glass wafers on top and bottom side to form a z-axis accelerometer. So basically they are bonded, that means this is silicon and the upper side or lower side they are different materials like pyrex or glass, so they are basically anodically bonded. So that means these two wafers, they are separately taken, then they are connected together and applied some sort of high temperature or a particular process is there, and because of that they are just joined together, that is called as the wafer bonding. So two wafers we are bonding, one is the silicon wafer, another is the glass wafer or the pyrex, right? Okay, now for this particular case this can be done by the bulk surface micromachining and wafer bonding. This is the technology we can use to fabricate this type of structure. Now the structure will have two differential sense capacitors with proof mass forming the, where the proof mass will form the middle electrode and metal on the glass wafers will form the top and bottom electrodes, right? So this already we have discussed. And air gap is formed by recessing the silicon on glass wafers, fine. So we have to form air gap in between this so that it can move freely, and because of the movement the gap change will happen and it will lead to the change in capacitance, which can be further converted into voltage, right? So this is one type of capacitive accelerometer, and this is another type of capacitive accelerometer where this middle one, this is the large proof mass and these are the four springs, these are the four springs, fine, they are connected to the anchored region, and with this proof mass in either sides we have some that beams are attached, and another sets of beams are also there which are in interdigitated configurations, and this particular configurations is also useful to develop the capacitive accelerometer, and in the next slides we will show the animated video as well for this type of capacitive accelerometers. And this type of accelerometer, the first one, that can be fabricated using the bulk micromachining and wafer bonding technique, whereas if we want to go for this type of mechanisms or this type of design, so then we have to go for this surface micromachining, because this particular thing is more elegant and more sophisticated. And as you remember that in bulk micromachining we can fabricate some that limited geometry, but in surface micromachining we can that any type of geometry almost is possible, fine. And in case of surface micromachining there are certain advantages as well, that the surface micromachining accelerometer, it will offer the opportunity to integrate the sensor and interface circuit on a single chip, and it will enable detection of very small capacitance variations as well, and even sensor and interface electronics can be implemented in a small area also, Fine. And another options can be high precision accelerometer using a combined surface and bulk micromachining technique. So that is also another technology which can be used for fabricating the capacitive accelerometer. So basically in these slides our discussion was on that what are the different MEMS technology we can use to fabricate the capacitive type accelerometer. So that we have successfully described. Okay. Is it okay? Or any doubts? Yeah. So here you can see the animation of this comb dive capacitive accelerometer. So in the previous slides, the second figure what we have shown, that is the this figure what we have shown, so that is the schematic view are this one. So here with the help of these pictorial illustrations we can show this, right? So if you look at this one, so here this is your proof mass and these are the four springs. This black one correspond to the anchor sides, fine. And here are the some beams are attached to this, fine. Now when it is subjected to some acceleration in either sides, so then what will happen? Suppose the right side if it moves, so then here the beams which are attached to the proof mass, they are moving, but these sides whatever beams are there, they are fixed, they are not moving, right? So then what will happen in one side, the if it moves in right side, so then right side the gap will decrease and here the gap will increase, and here again essentially these are the three electrodes we can think of. This middle one is the moving electrode and left and right they are the fixed electrode. So here we can consider C2, here we can consider C1. So when it is going right side, then CS2 or C2 that will increase and CS1 will decrease, and if it moves in the left side, the other things will happen, fine. So here is the more that pictorial representation. So here you can see that this bluish is the proof mass along with this beams which are attached to this, and these are the springs, four springs, and these are the anchored region, these square portions, right? So they are fixed regions. Now when the acceleration is applied, this will move in this orientations, and here we have another interdigitated type electrode configurations which are fixed, which are shown in green color. And then you can see if it moves in either sides, so in one with respect to one beam the capacitance or the gap is decreasing, whereas with respect to the other sides the gap is increasing, and that will essentially lead to the delta C, right? So one side capacitance will increase, another side capacitance will decrease. So here is again further illustration. So you can see that when it is going in the left side, so then the gap between this and this will decrease, whereas gap between this and this will increase, or the vice versa, right? Now what we can do, that this right side, all these things we can sort together, and from here we can take one terminal. Similarly from the left side also we'll take all the things together, and that we will connect it another terminal, and these will be the two terminal, and from the middle proof mass we will take out one connection. So basically this all these things they will be forming three equivalent parallel plates of the capacitance, which will form the C1 and C2, or CS1 and C2, CS2, right? And basically here, by using this interdigitated configurations and array of beam configurations, we are essentially multiplying that capacitance. If we have one plate, then the value of C will be epsilon A by D. If we have n plate, then it will be simply n into epsilon A by D. So to increase the sensitivity or the capacitance value further, we are just using this type of array configuration, right? So I hope you have understood the basic operations principle of the capacitive type accelerometer. Is it okay? Or any doubts? Yeah. If you don't have any doubts, so then we will go for the next slide where we will discuss about the circuits which are used for this capacitive accelerometer. So this is the signal conditioning circuit. So what essentially we have to do? So mostly we prefer this differential configuration, right? Because differential configurations is preferable to avoid some unnecessary effects, right? And its performance is better with respect to the single capacitor. So what type of configurations we will choose. So suppose why we choose differential capacitance, like this will be the equivalent circuits. So when no acceleration is applied, then C1 and C2 both are same and output will be zero. Now when the C1 will increase, then suppose output should increase, or if C2 is increased, then output should decrease. Some type of configurations we should use, right? Now this, since two capacitors we are using differential configurations, this often we call as the half bridge configuration, because in full bridge we need four arms, four elements, but since we are using two elements, we are calling it as the half bridge configuration. And since we are measuring the capacitance, so the excitation voltage should not be DC, right? So it should be AC. So that's why here we are applying some square wave with some certain amplitude and certain frequency here, and to detect the orientation, that whether the probe mass is moving in the right side or left side. So that's why this out of phase square wave are applied. So here you can see this is plus BS, then this should be minus BS. So basically this is the some square wave with certain amplitude and frequency, and this is also another square wave which will be this square wave will be connected here, and this square will be connected here, and once, so they are out of phase, fine. So this out of phase is taken to detect the directions of the movement or the acceleration, fine. Okay, now if you just solve this particular simple circuit, so then what you will get, if you just put the nodal analysis here, so this V0 will be simply minus Vs, because here we have minus Vs, here we have plus Vs, and here whatever voltage you will be getting, that will be the minus Vs plus, this is some sort of that voltage divider type of things is happening, right? Now you can consider that will be simply C1 by C1 plus C2 into 2 Vs. 2 Vs is the difference, Vs minus of minus Vs, that is the 2 Vs. So this V0 output can be given by this one, C1 minus C2 by C1 plus C2 into Vs, fine. So C1 plus C2, that will be known to us, and the C1 minus C2, that will be actually the, because of the acceleration, the X will change, because of the X change, the C1 minus C2, or that will be the delta C will change, and that is converted into voltage with the help of this bridge circuit, fine. Now how can we convert that, further take the output, what we can do? So this is your bridge circuit, here we are getting this V output, or this here we are giving the name as Vx, then that we can connect it to some simple buffer circuits to avoid the loading effect, and this output will be this V0, and also this CP is the parasitic capacitance. So as we said, the capacitive mechanisms, although it is advantageous, but the disadvantage is that it will include the parasitic effect as well, fine. Now if you solve this circuit, so then this V0 will be simply that Vx, but this Vx will be not only a function of C1 and C2, but also the CP factor will come into the picture. And that means, what I can understand, the output voltage V0 is a function of delta C. The delta C is my main prime requirement, that because of the acceleration X is changing, and because of the X, the delta C is changing, fine. Now this delta C is converted into voltage, but in this voltage output, in addition to this delta C, the CP factor is also coming into the picture, that is the parasitic capacitance. And as we said, that is the disadvantage of the capacitive type device, where parasitic effect will be there. And obviously parasitic, the CP value is unknown to us, and that CP can change depending on the environment, but that CP is our undesired things. So we have to build some circuits which will that avoid or exclude the effect of the CP, so that the output should be fully function of the delta C, and we can avoid the CP. So how we can do that? That we can see in the next slide. So this is called as the charge amplifier configuration. So don't get afraid by looking at the circuit. So this is quite simple one. In the previous slides, we have shown this one, right? This half bridge configuration. Upper C1, lower C2, here plus V0, here some plus Vs, here some minus Vs we have considered. Just here plus V0 by 2, V0 by 2 likewise we have mentioned. And here just for example, if this is your C0, suppose initial capacitance is C0, and if the delta, if the because of the applied acceleration, if this upper side increases by delta c, so then the lower side will decrease by delta c. So this is, for example, c naught plus delta c, this is c naught minus delta c, fine. And then what we have, the CPU is there, that is because of the parasitic. Now in the previous slides we have used a simple buffer, and because of that in the output expression also the presence of CPU is there. Now in this particular configuration, what we have used, we have used a inverting amplifier configuration that is called as the charge amplifier, because it is amplifying the charge, you can think of. So this is a simple some sort of integrated type arrangement, and here we have a feedback capacitor, fine. And because of this negative feedback, we know that in this case of negative feedback, this plus terminal is ground, it is zero. So if it is zero, then in this negative terminal also it will be zero, right? So essentially it will be zero, and here also zero, since both are zero, so then this effect of CPU will be nullified. So by using this charge amplifier or this integrated type arrangement, we can essentially nullify the CPU. How we are nullifying? As we say, let us repeat it. So this is your, this plus terminal is grounded at a zero. So because of the negative feedback virtual short concept, here also zero will come, and that means here also zero. Now across the capacitor, this is also zero, this is also zero. So that means this capacitance effect will be nullified. And the output, if we calculate, that will be fully out function of the delta C. And this feedback capacitor's value will be also, that will be also there. And since this C int, we will be that adding here, and delta C is the, basically the delta C is a function of my acceleration. So with the help of this type of circuits, we can convert the acceleration into delta C and delta C into voltage. And here the, you can see in this final expression, the effect of CP is not there. So in this way, by including this charge amplifier configurations, we can eliminate the effect of parasitic capacitance as well, fine. Is it okay? Yeah. So if you are fine with this, so then in the next slide, just some that examples we have shown here. So here the first one is the MS3110, that is one capacitance sensing IC. So this is the internal circuit diagram of the IC. So you that may not go through the details of this one, just to give you the idea. Suppose if I have a MEMS capacitive sensor, so then I can use this MS3110 capacitance sensing IC, which I can integrate with my MEMS sensor, and this IC will convert the delta C into the voltage. And this is the internal circuit configurations of this particular IC, right? Where the CS1, CS2, that value will come from your MEMS sensor, right? And another example here we call as the ADXL150. This particular model of this accelerometer, that will include both the sensor, and here also this comb drive type of capacitive accelerometer are there, and the circuits are also integrated together. So in this ADXL150 IC, both the MEMS sensors as well as the IC are integrated together, and this will give you the final voltage output, and the accelerations will be directly converted into voltage output. So these are just for representation purpose some example IC's names we have shown here. Right. So with this, we have completed the discussion on capacitive, that piezoresistive and capacitive accelerometer. Fine. So hope you have understood the basic concepts, the working principles, the design aspects, analysis, fabrication technology, and the circuits parts as well, that the signal conditioning circuits which we can use for interfacing purpose. Fine. And even there are certain accelerometer type of device which can give you direct the digital output as well, right? Like ADXL335, that accelerometer will give you analog output, whereas ADXL345, that particular model can give you the directly the digital output, which you can directly connect it to the your embedded controller like Arduino board, fine. And that can directly, that can be connected even without ADC, and it will give you the corresponding electrical output, which will be calibrated or which will be useful to measure your unknown acceleration, right? Okay. So if you have any doubts, so please feel free to get it clarified either by online mode or offline mode, or if you are interested, you can visit to my office as well individually during any convenient time. Okay, thank you.